Last time we started the topic of partition affinity on CW complexes. We proved the major theorem there, namely existence of partition affinity subordinate to any open covering, assuming one of the propositions. Let me recall that proposition first here. So it's an elaborate proposition which says that given a partition affinity, suppose X is obtained by attaching K cells to Y, okay, then given a partition affinity on Y, you can extend it to a partition affinity on X. Moreover, the local finite ensured in the covering which ensures local finiteness for Y will get extended to the covering which ensures local finiteness for X in such a way that the sets themselves, you know, are extended themselves intersecting with Y will be the corresponding open subset. The open subsets themselves are also getting extended here. Before proving this one, we will need another step, namely one at a time. What you have got here is X is obtained by attaching Y. Obtained by attaching K cells to Y. There may be infinitely many cells. So what we want to do is first do it for one cell at a time. And that is same thing as saying that start with a open cover for Dn or Dk and a partition affinity subordinate to the restricted cover on Sk minus 1, on the boundary. So you must be able to do the same thing here, whatever is done here, for that particular case. So that is our first lemma we want to prove. Okay. So let's go to that lemma now. So this is the lemma we want to prove right now. So U be a open covering for Dn, theta, eta alpha, alpha belong to lambda, be a partition affinity on the boundary Sn minus 1 subordinate to the restricted covering U restricted to Sn minus 1. Then there is an extension of theta to a partition affinity theta hat on Dn, which is subordinate to the given covering U. Okay. The proposition is same thing with infinitely many cells at a time, at the same time. And then just it's not Sn minus 1, it's happening inside Y and so on. But let us first prove this one. So this is the major thing that we have to do. Okay. So let beta from lambda to I be a refinement function for theta. That means what? Support of eta alpha on Sn minus 1, its intersection Sn minus 1, is just to emphasize that support of eta alpha is a subset of Sn minus 1. It's contained inside U beta alpha intersection Sn minus 1 for every alpha inside lambda. So this is the open covering of Sn minus 1. Okay. By the compactness of Sn minus 1, okay, and because the entire family is locally finite, Sn minus finite is compact, the whole thing will be what? Actually finite. There will be only finitely many non-zero functions here. So it follows that you can find a uniform epsilon, 0, less than epsilon, less than 1. Okay, and open subsets A alpha in Sn minus 1, okay, such that support of eta alpha intersection Sn minus 1 is contained inside these are whiskers. Remember what is this definition, n epsilon of A alpha, okay, and then its closure, and that is contains a U beta alpha. U beta alpha is a given open subsets from the open cover, you take u beta alpha intersection Sn minus 1. This you can take it as your A alpha. Indeed, that will be open subset which will contain support of eta alpha intersection Sn minus 1. If needed, you can take even smaller than there is no need actually. That itself will work. So, but instead of saying that, I have said that there exists such a thing, that's all. So you take the closure of that, that will contain this one. That closure is contained in this one. For ensuring that this closure is here, you may have to take a smaller thing, that's all. Here we are using the notation of lemma 1.2, which you remember, these are collars of length epsilon, of width epsilon, all points coming from rays coming from the center to a point inside Sn minus 1. Okay, but take a point on Sn minus 1 and then take a portion of the ray of length epsilon. So these are the union of all those things. As A varies over, as the point varies over A alpha, that will be as N epsilon alpha. So take the closure of that. Okay, now let R from N epsilon Sn minus 1 bar to Sn minus 1 be the retraction. What is the retraction? These are points of Dn, remember. So x divided by x divided by norm x. So that will push back, push the vector back to the boundary. Okay, so that is a retraction. Put eta prime of alpha as eta alpha composite with retraction. So eta alpha is defined on Sn minus 1. Okay, so now you compose it with this retraction, it will defined on N epsilon Sn minus 1 closure of this one. Okay. So it's defined, it's just eta alpha composite R. R of that will be inside Sn minus 1. So eta alpha makes sense. So that is the definition of eta alpha prime. So I have extended all eta alpha in a small neighborhood of Sn minus 1. Okay, and this neighborhood I have very specifically said what it is. It follows that support of this eta alpha prime, okay, this will be all these points wherein they go inside support of eta alpha here. Okay, so support of eta alpha prime is also contained inside u beta. So the whole thing is contains u beta here. All right. So eta alpha primes are extended very carefully. Now by T's extension theorem, there exist continuous functions, eta alpha second, eta alpha people read double prime also, eta alpha second. Prime is one, double to two dashes are prime, second. Eta alpha second, D and two, I'll be, these are extensions of eta alpha. See, eta alpha prime is defined only on this closed set. It's a closed subset of Dn. So I extend it to the whole of Dn. That's all. How I get extension, I don't know. This T-section theorem, there is an extension. Okay. And this is not good. I want to control this one. So I will do that later. So by Urizon's lemma, there exists a map G from Dn to I, which is zero on the complement of U beta, which is a closed set. Okay. U beta is an open subset of Dn. So take the complement inside Dn. So there it is one, there it is zero, and one on the support of eta alpha prime. Remember, eta alpha prime is contained in U beta. So these two are disjoint closed subsets. So I can do this one, okay? Now put eta alpha bar is a modification of this extension, namely G times eta alpha. It's a cutoff. So this is the modification I want. So what is the property of this one? This will be one on the complement, okay, wherever it was defined, but zero on the complement. So it has, again, its support will be inside U beta, and one on the support of eta alpha prime. On eta alpha prime, it will not change it. Okay. So all that I want is eta alpha prime with all these properties to be extended to the whole of it, but its support must be inside U beta only. That's all. Okay, so these are eta alpha bars. Okay. Next, let us look at all those points wherein sum of all these eta alphas is zero. Remember, sum of these eta alphas is a finite sum here now. Okay. All indexing I am writing that with that way, but the number of things which we have started with the non-zero things, they are only finitely many. All other things are zero. You extend them by zero with for the whole of Dn, no problem. Okay. So this summation, okay, it is definitely equal to one on the boundary Sn minus one. It is a partition affinity. Okay. So suppose this is zero. If it's not zero, this f will be empty. I have no problem. If it is zero, let us take all those points that is a closed subset f of Dn. Now you choose a partition affinity phi a belong to A on Dn, which is subordinate to this open covering. Some other partition affinity you take. Okay. So we'll put them these two together in a nice way so that the old thing eta alphas, these alphas, they are not covering the whole thing, you see. They are partly zero on f. If this is f is empty, then I could have taken this itself divided by the sum, then I would have a partition affinity. Since I cannot do that, I have to take another partition affinity phi a, okay, on Dn, which is subordinate to u, and look at all those a prime, a belonging to a, such that support of phi a intersection f is non-empty. So those are the ones which are important for me. Amongst all these, so this a is actually a finite set. Okay, I don't need that. So look at all those points, all those functions which are non-zero on f. Support of phi alpha intersection f is at least closer to that. Support should not be should intersect f. Doesn't mean that f is actually non-zero, but support of phi alpha intersection f is non-empty. So keep those functions. Okay. Let gamma from a prime to I. This is a subset of this one. Be such that support of phi alpha is contained inside some u gamma a. What is gamma a? Gamma a is a point of I, is an indexing point. So it contains some u alpha because I have started with a partition which is subordinate to u, right here. Partition of index subordinate to u. For all a inside a prime, I have a refinement function there. Put lambda prime equal to lambda union this extra a prime, okay? And beta prime equal to lambda on beta on lambda prime and this beta prime on a prime, gamma on a prime. Okay, extend beta to beta prime in this way. Okay, by taking then this beta prime will be a refinement function for the new family along with eta alphas, eta alpha bars. The only thing now left out is to make them into partition affinity. They are some smooth functions. Their supports cover the whole of Dn. That much I have ensured. So this is what is. So this was some my f. So there is some u1 here. Okay, for each of them there is something. So I have put the whole of f inside u1. Doesn't matter. So f is covered by some u alpha, this u. U gamma a belong to a prime. Then there are other things which cover the rest of Sn minus 1, u alpha, u beta. Okay, you can study this picture as a model. This n epsilons are this is the color of the boundary here. Okay, finally, notice that on the boundary, not only on the boundary, on this collar itself, because we have defined this as retraction theta alpha bar by using this retraction. The sum total of eta alpha bars is one, because that is the case on the sphere. So it is true on the neighborhood also. Okay, in this part, it is identically one eta alpha bar tensors are one. And therefore, n epsilon Sn minus 1 closure intersection F is empty, because F is where sum total is 0. So these two are disjoint closed subsets. So now I take one more Urizon's lemma here, that phi from Dn to I be a continuous function such that phi of F is 1 and phi of this n epsilon Sn minus 1 bar is 0. Okay, so that the extra functions are multiplied by this function phi, so they are not disturbed, but they don't enter n epsilon. So there is a killing, this function is killing, so that's what I am doing. Phi A is all of them are multiplied by phi. So they don't enter this caller at all. Okay, so that is the point. And inside this whatever cover for F, there they are identically one. So their values on F, that hasn't changed. So that is the whole idea. Therefore, what happens is, away from F, this eta bar, sum total of eta bars is non-zero. On F, this summation is not zero. Therefore, this capital phi, which is sum of all these, will never be zero. Okay. And this being a finite sum of continuous functions, it will be continuous on the whole of Dn. So I can divide by this function. Eta, alpha, hat, these are the final modification of my eta, alpha we started with. First I take eta, alpha bar, then eta, alpha prime, and eta, alpha double prime, and eta, alpha bar, and eta, alpha hat now. Okay. So eta, alpha hat is eta, alpha bar by capital phi. Lambda A is all phi A into phi divided by phi. So that now if we take the sum of these, it will be equal to 1. So we put them eta alpha hats on A in lambda, and lambda A from A prime. This is my extension. This is the extended family. Okay. It's obviously partition of unity because I have divided by this capital phi, which is sum total. And subordinate also we have taken, because we have taken this beta prime in this exactly same way. Wherever eta alpha bar is not zero, the same thing as this one, because you are dividing by a non-zero function, that's all. So the subordination function, etc., doesn't change. Okay. So condition 2 and 3 have to be, 1 and 4 we have verified. Condition 2 and 3 we have to yet ensure. Okay. So that theta hat actually becomes an extension. There are four conditions, remember that. So start with eta alpha, which is equal to eta alpha bar on Sk minus 1. Therefore, this phi total sum total is identically 1 on Sn minus 1. These things are 0. So these will sum up to 1 here. And hence, eta alpha hat, which is eta alpha bar, okay, which is equal to eta alpha on Sk minus 1. The sum total is 1, and I'm dividing by that one. So if sum total on Sn minus 1, if this, whatever you're dividing is 1, eta alpha hat will be eta alpha bar. But eta alpha bar is eta alpha, that we have seen already. Therefore, these are actually extensions. Okay, restricted to Sn minus 1, they are old functions. So this takes care of 3. Okay. Finally, let W equal to Wx, x belong to Sn minus 1, be an open cover for Sn minus 1, which ensures local finiteness for theta. We have to get an open cover Wx hat for Dn, which ensures local finiteness for theta hat, such that f of W hat is same thing as f of w. This f is the set of all points, all indexes, okay, wherein theta alphas, the eta alphas are non-zero. That is what this f is, okay. So notice that because of the compactness of Dn, local finiteness is obvious. That is not the point. But what are the open subsets which ensure that? Have you extended them? That is the important point here. However, the emphasis is on latter half of the condition, which has to be handled correctly. So that has to be verified. Okay. So for that, I have to do this work, namely, define w hat of x to be n epsilon of wx. Remember, what is n epsilon? So in this picture, if this is wx, something here like wx, n epsilon will be growing it up to this collar like this, like that. Okay, don't go out of n epsilon. Put up all that, this much of collar for that. That is the definition of n epsilon. Okay, so w hat of x, if x is in Sn minus 1, take n epsilon of wx. Intersection with Sn minus 1, it's with wx. So that part is fine. In the interior, you take whatever you like, actually. You take the whole of Dn, one single set. That's an open subset of Dn anyway. All right? So x is the interior of Dn. So clearly, the family is an open cover for Dn. And as a remark, as we were earlier, wx hat ensures local finiteness for theta. Local finiteness because there are no finitely many of them. But the indexing sets are also correct, is what we have to say. We have to verify that f of this n epsilon x, these are the old things, right? They must be f of wx. Okay. There are no extra indexes coming here, this is what you have to show. For this, we observe first of all that if you take lambda a, these are the new things. Lambda a intersection n epsilon Sn minus 1 is empty. And these n epsilon wx are contained inside this one. Therefore, this lambda a, support of lambda a intersection, this f n epsilon is empty. Okay. So wx is contained as n epsilon of wx. And r from this one is retraction. Therefore, eta hat of alpha z is eta prime of z, which is eta alpha of r z, where z belongs to n epsilon x. For every point in that neighborhood, you push it to the boundary and then take the value. This r z is the z divided by norm z, right? So that is the condition C there. From A and B, it follows that both sides of this 5 are contained inside lambda. The what is lambda prime? It consists of lambda and A prime. The members of A prime don't come here. This is precisely what I want to say. Okay, support of lambda A intersection, this is empty. That is part A. Okay, so these are all set. Both the sets are inside lambda. They are okay. But why they are equal? Equal because of this B. From B, it follows that f of wx is what? Point alpha subset eta alpha is not zero, right? On wx, it's contained inside f of nw, is a larger thing, okay? Because it's a retraction, this is contained inside this one, that's all. It's larger. Finally, take alpha belonging to n epsilon, f of n epsilon wx, larger one. Take a point here. Okay, f of that one. Okay, what is the meaning of this? There exists a set inside this one, set eta hat of alpha z is not zero. But eta half of f z, eta bar of alpha z. And that is eta bar of r z. If this is not zero, but r z is a point of wx. So I have got a point in wx, eta alpha is not zero. That means this alpha is inside wx, f of wx. So every point of f of wx is there, which is not actually, we need to have that one. One way is enough, but they are actually equal is what I have proved. So this completes the proof of the lemma, having stated that, okay. So this was the hardest part of the entire story of partition affinity for this one. Okay, now we can compute the proposition 1.4 very easily. Okay, and this was needed. This is very important. Otherwise, when you go to infinitely many things, namely at a single vertex, for example, you might have attached infinitely many one cells. Okay, then for each of these epsilons, if you choose, they can go keep going smaller and smaller. And you never know what is happening there. So you have to control that. On the other hand, this part was not at all necessary if we had assumed that the CW complex is locally finite. Okay, we'd want to prove it for all CW complexes, not just locally finite CW complexes. Okay, so the last part is not very difficult at all. To start with a open cover for U, open cover for X, okay, theta, beta, alpha, lambda belong to partition of infinity on Y, and beta be the infinite function, and W be the open covering which ensures the local finiteness of theta. Okay, for each J in J, let us have fj from sk minus 1 to y with attaching map for the jth cell dk. It's an attaching map, okay? And phi j from dk to x with a characteristic map. Okay, this is defined from all of for each dj or each dk. Now consider theta j, okay? J is fixed, j is an integer. Theta j to be eta alpha composite fj. Okay, so I am pulling back the partition of unity defined on y. I don't want the whole of y. I want it only on sn minus 1. Sn minus 1 to y, I have map f, continuous function. You pull it back on sn minus 1. So fj eta alpha composite fj. So these will be partition of unity on sk minus 1. And subordinate to which one? Subordinate to fj inverse of uis. Fj inverse of ui, which is a restriction of an open cover, phi j inverse of ui. If you take phi j inverse of ui, that will be an open cover for dk. Okay? So this is a restriction. So now I apply the previous lemma. Okay, for each of these. Now I have my entire attention is on one single dk, one single cell. Okay. So by applying above lemma, we obtain extension theta j hat. Let us denote them by psi j alpha, where alpha belongs to lambda union lambda j. There I had lambda union lambda prime, but that was only one. Now I have to index it, which will depend upon which fj I have taken, so I index it by lambda j, that's all. Okay, of theta j, okay, on dk, which is subordinate to phi j inverse of ui. What is the cover? This is the cover, it's the open cover for each I. Okay, with the refinement function again beta j from lambda union lambda j to I, which is an extension of beta. All these the lemma guarantees me. For each j, I have an epsilon there, but that epsilon I will term index by epsilon j. 0 less than epsilon j less than 1, as in the lemma. For each w inside w, okay, and each j inside j, look w epsilon j to be, take fj inverse of w's, okay? For each w, fj inverse of w you take, then take n epsilon j of that. Okay, all these, if you drop out this j here and f here and so on, this is the lemma. So instead of arbitrary w, now I have f inverse of j, fj inverse of w's there, that's all. Okay, let us take this one. So this is shorter notation, epsilon wj, instead of big this one. We then have an extension of the members of the open cover fj inverse of w of sn minus 1 to open subset, this W epsilon J, W belongs W, these are open subsets of DK, such that their intersection with SA minus 1 is precisely FJ inverse of W, because it's N epsilon J of U. That's an extension of this. That's the property that for each J, the indexing sets, F of set of all indexes here, F of W epsilon J is same thing as F of the intersection with SN minus 1, FJ inverse of W. Okay. And that is precisely equal to FW because I have taken FJ inverse of the function to be precisely what is eta j of FJ. Okay, that's why it is FW. Okay, whatever happens inside Y, all those only I have kept there here. So this is a restriction. This is the pullback of the cover of the functions on Y. Okay. Put lambda prime equal to lambda union all these lambda j's as j varies over the indexing set now. Indexing set j. Okay. Let beta prime be the extension of these all these on lambda it is beta and lambda j it is beta j's. So take that one. All the beta j's we have extended. For each alpha belonging to lambda prime, define rho alpha prime from the disjoint union of y and all the dk's. On the disjoint union, you define first, namely on as follows. On y, it must be always eta alphas. No change there. Okay. On y, let rho prime of alpha be eta alpha, where alpha is inside lambda. For all the new things, it must be zero. Okay, that's what we want anyway. We don't want the new things to enter y, right? So on y, it is this. These are the functions. Okay. On dk alphas, what are they? On dk alphas, for each dkj, they must be, rho prime of x must be the new psi alpha j of x, if alpha is in this one. For other lambda j's, of course, they must be zero because they are disjoint anyway. So from all other lambda j's, must be zero. Okay. So this is now the collection of these all rho alphas. Okay. They are defined on dk, the additional dk union y, but when you attach along the boundary, what happens to this one? They will agree with the corresponding function in y here. Okay, because this is just eta alpha composite, the functions were nothing but what? Eta alpha composite f alpha, fj's. Okay, so they, all these functions will now factor down to define a continuous function from x to y. For each of them, there will be a rho alpha prime. If I drop that prime, rho alpha from x to y. If you look at the quotient map, so rho alpha of qx, x is some point there, is equal to rho alpha prime of x. That is the way you have defined. So it is well defined because of on the boundary, Sn minus 1, f, they are fj's, given by fj's. Okay, we claim that this family is required partition of unity, which extends the order in a partition of unity on Y. Okay, that is very clear because that these on Y they agree with this one by the very definition. That part is fine. Okay, so let us verify one by one. If alpha is in lambda, then rho alpha restricted to y is eta alpha. Okay, on each phi j of the dk of j, so rho alpha composite phi j is rho alpha prime, which is psi j of alpha, then support of this one is contained in u prime beta. u beta, but on lambda it is equal to beta prime. Okay, capital lambda, it is same thing as one. Now suppose alpha is in some lambda j, and such a thing is unique, right? Alpha is either in lambda or in one of the lambda j's. Then support of rho alpha is phi j of, see, support of psi j is usually psi j of alpha. Okay, I have to take phi j. Phi j's are the characteristic functions, right? Phi j of support of alpha. That is inside u of beta j's. Okay, so because we have pulled back this, the inverse image of these things for the original cover. Okay, so it is u of beta j, but beta j's are by definition, beta prime is beta j when alpha is in lambda j. So it is u of beta j. Therefore, the family theta is subordinate to the open cover u with beta prime as the refinement function. Okay. Now, let us take w belong to w, the old, the local finiteness eschewing covering for y. Put w epsilon, okay, I want to extend each of them, how? Equal to q of each w epsilon alpha, this is w epsilon j. Epsilon, w epsilon j's are inside, happening inside each disk dj, right? So each disk, you take this column, take the union of all that, and q of that, the image of that, okay? So that is my w epsilon. Automatically, this w epsilon becomes open subset in X. Because intersection with each dj, if you take the inverse image, it will w epsilon j. Okay, so each w epsilon is an open subset of X. Also for each j, let us take wj denote the interior of tk, phi of that. Remember, phi j is a homeomorphism on the interior. So look at the copy of that. That is my wj. Okay. Now you take all the w epsilons, w's coming from capital W or curly W, add this extra interior of each cells. That is an open cover for the whole of X. And that will ensure local finiteness for theta hat. As far as all these y's are concerned, it will come from w epsilon. Inside these things, inside each dj, only things which are non-zero in this interior of this one are coming from dj. So that is will be only lambda j. So it's a local finite. This will ensure local finiteness. Okay. Finally, we have to look at this patching up the indexing sets themselves. F of wj for each j, f of wj, set of all alpha in lambda j, lambda prime, support of rho alpha intersection w is non-empty, is a definition. Okay. As soon as you write j here, this will be happening in lambda union lambda j. Right? For each j, this is what it's inside this particular thing. Now, by the compactness of dk and local finiteness of theta j, it follows that only finitely members of theta j's are non-zero here. So therefore, it follows that this f of wj is finite. Similarly, for w inside w, first observe that f of w epsilon is all lambda inside alpha inside lambda prime. Support of rho alpha intersection w epsilon is non-empty. So this may be because w epsilons are infinitely many w epsilon j's are there, okay? But the whole thing is, none of them will contribute anything from, acquire anything from these lambda j's. This is the whole important thing. So it is a subset of lambda itself. So this is the key here. So this is the final thing here. So we have extra thing, if you allow one of them, then you don't know how many you have allowed. So I don't allow any of them. So whether they are finite or infinite doesn't care. So no new things come here. So it is considered lambda. But then f of w epsilon is same thing as union of all these wj's, because that is the definition of w epsilon. Okay. And but each of them is fw zero. Okay. So finally, this summation is similar to the final theorem also. We had this one for any x in x, suppose x is inside y, then rho x is 0 for if lambda alpha x is not in lambda. All these lambda j's, they are all those functions are 0, right? So only the summation here in lambda prime summation, only alphas which are inside lambda will contribute. But then this is a partition of unity on y, therefore it must be x. So it is eta alpha of x, so it is 1. Otherwise, x is inside one of the phi j of integer of dk of alpha, dk of j. Okay, that j is unique also. Okay, then x equal to phi j of x prime for some x inside that, because it is in phi j of this one. In this case, rho alpha x is 0 for all alpha not in lambda j prime, where j prime is, sorry, all of j inside j prime, where j prime is not equal to j. Only when it is in lambda j, okay, you will get something. So this sum total will be all, either it is in lambda j or in lambda. Okay. So all this big thing doesn't come. So only lambda union lambda j will come, summation. Because all other things are 0. Rho alpha of x is 0. Right? Because x is infinite in dk of j. That's why. But these are, by definition, psi j alpha. Okay. On this one, on this dk, it is a partition of unity. Therefore, it is equal to 1. Okay. So this completes the proof that theta hat is an extension of theta. So this part is easy. It is more or less the repetition of the final theorem that we have proved in some sense, except that this is the key thing here, okay, which ensures that the local finiteness is ensured here because of this one. Okay. Yeah. So I have told you already that the existence of partition of unity with Hausdorffness actually ensures that the space is paracompact. If you don't know paracompactness, you don't have to worry about that right now. The paracompactness is essentially, in practice, it is essentially to prove the existence of partition of unity. That is the key in all the analysis everywhere, in algebraic topology or differential geometry, wherever you want. Okay. But some basic points of topology has to be done like that. That is why Diodone has thought about this partition of unity. Okay. So that was the theorem that I was telling, corollary. Every CW complex is a paracompact. I think this is where we stop today. Thank you.